One of the things I've been thinking about in terms of this Revelation series, I'll do that. The book of Revelation is a complicated and difficult book to preach through, as I've mentioned before, and it's difficult to analyze and difficult to understand the symbolism in there. It is, however, a beautifully written book with a lot of tremendous imagery and just wonderful scenes, you know, if you will. And I've been struck lately by how much the book of Revelation doesn't belong so much to the theologians or to the pastors or to the scholars. The book of Revelation belongs, in a way, to the artists, to the musicians, to the poets. It's a book that speaks that kind of language. It's written in that kind of form. And that's one of the reasons it's so popular with folks who express themselves in that way. And I debated about whether or not I was going to start with this, but I decided I'm going to. So I'm going to take 4.5 minutes of my sermon time and play a song by Johnny Cash that refers directly to the passage that I'm going to preach on here. And so if it's not your type of music, whatever, I'm sorry. Just for this next 4.5 minutes, just grit your teeth. I happen to love this song. It's Johnny Cash in his later years when he had a little bit more artistic freedom to sing about things that were near and dear to his heart. And this was one of the things. And so I'm just going to go ahead and let Elizabeth do that, and then we'll talk.
I heard, as it were, the noise of thunder. One of the four beasts saying, "Come and see." And I saw, and behold, a white horse.
There's a man going round taking names. And he decides who to free and who to blame. Everybody won't be treated all the same. There'll be a golden ladder reaching down when the man comes around. The hairs on your arm will stand up at the terror in each sip and in each sup. Will you partake of that last offered cup or disappear into the potter's ground when the man comes around? Hear the trumpets, hear the pipers, 100 million angels singing. Multitudes are marching to the big kettle drum. Voices calling, voices crying. Some are born and some are dying. It's Alpha and Omega's kingdom come. And the whirlwind is in the thorn tree. The virgins are all trimming their wicks. Is in the thorn tree. It's hard for thee to kick against the pricks. Till Armageddon, no shalom, no shalom. Then the father hen will call his chickens home. The wise men will bow down before the throne. And at his feet they'll cast their golden crowns. Whoever is unjust, let him be unjust still. Whoever is righteous, let him be righteous still. Whoever is filthy, let him be filthy still. Listen to the words long written down when the man comes around. Hear the trumpets, hear the pipers. 100 million angels singing. Multitudes are marching to the big kettle drum. Voices calling, voices crying. Some are born and some are dying. It's Alpha and Omega's kingdom come. And the whirlwind is in the thorn tree. The virgins are all trimming their wicks. The whirlwind is in the thorn tree. It's hard for thee to kick against the pricks. In measured a hundredweight and penny pound, when the man comes around.
And I heard a voice in the midst of the four beasts, and I looked, and behold, a pale horse, and his name that sat on him was Death, and Hell followed with him.
Spruce up your home this season and paint.
It's not actually part of the song. Yeah, the opposite, that's right. I do love that song. There's a couple things about it just to note. One of the things that things I discovered in researching that song, that image of the whirlwind and the thorn tree, which I really like that image, that's not actually from the Bible. That's not a biblical image. Someone told Johnny Cash at one point, Johnny Cash, you're like a whirlwind and a thorn tree, just creating chaos everywhere you go. If you know something about his life or watched a biopic or anything, you know his life was pretty chaotic and he made a lot of mistakes. And when he says the whirlwind is in the thorn tree, and he says it's hard for you to kick against the pricks, against the goads, you know, kicking against God's commands, he's talking about himself. He's talking about his life and his struggle with God through his whole life, really. I mean, he struggled with his faith. He struggled with addiction. He struggled with fidelity in his marriage. He had, you know, he had kind of almost a caricature of a rock and roll lifestyle, but he never let go of Jesus. He never let go of Jesus. And he knew that he was in trouble unless he gave his life to Jesus. And so you can understand why these images from the book of Revelation are so powerful for him and so meaningful to him personally. And indeed, to anyone who finds themselves in need of a savior before the throne of God. Amen? Right, because you don't have to be Johnny Cash to make a mess out of your life or out of somebody else's life or anything of that nature. So I continually come back to this thought, this book of Revelation is, it has specific things in it that are really important for us to hear and understand, but they're so poetic. And if we lose the poetry, we lose the book. And so it has to remain poetic to some degree. Poetic doesn't mean not real. I want to be very clear about that. But still, the imagery and whatnot is supposed to be evocative and beautiful. Okay. Let's go ahead and, well, okay, let's, yeah, go ahead and take me through. Oh, no, sorry, I'm jumping through. I wanted to mention, I put those inserts in to get the order of service this week. It's helpful for me sometimes to have just an outline of where we're going through. I also included on that something we spoke about several weeks ago in terms of the types of ways that people interpret Revelation. I know this is an oversimplification, but I included the four types of ways that sometimes people interpret Revelation, which is helpful if you're online and reading on blogs or things that Bible scholars say, and two people have two completely different takes on the same passage, and you can remember they're coming from very different, that their presuppositions are completely different. And then I put a very simple outline where it says the apocalypse, the simplest outline I could really find on the internet of the book of Revelation, just so you could kind of see where we're at. We're in vision one, the seven seals and the trumpets. And that's why I put the seven seals on the front here. This is what we're going to be talking about today. Yes, I do. Okay. So remember, these are the seven seals we're talking about. This is something what the scroll would have looked like, not exactly like this, but in the vision that it would have looked something somewhat similar to this, a rolled up scroll with seven seals on it. These are just a couple of paintings I found. I think I put that one on the front of the order of service. If you Google Book of Revelation paintings, Yeah, people have been making a lot of paintings for this book for many hundreds of years, and some are just really cool, some are bizarre. This one actually was one of my favorites. The colors are almost seem sort of Native American to me. It's kind of a subtle, captures the ominousness too of these four horsemen of the apocalypse. Okay, let's get into it. So remember that we've had this climactic scene in the throne room where Jesus has taken the scroll from God and he starts to break the seals. And this is really where the narrative of the book of Revelation starts, where in terms of the vision, we've had the letters to the churches and we've had this vision of the throne room, but now the wheels are turning. Now things are happening. And this is the beginning of that. The first is the seven seals of things happening. I watched as the Lamb opened the first of the seven seals. Then I heard one of the four living creatures say in a voice like thunder, "Come." I looked, and there before me was a white horse. Its rider held a bow, and he was given a crown, and he rode out as a conqueror bent on conquest. Now, if you're reading the book of Revelation sort of quickly and sort of lazily, you might think this was an image of Jesus. And it absolutely is not. This is not an image of Jesus. In fact, it's the Lamb who's opening these seals, right? Jesus doesn't open up the seal to send out Jesus. White can refer to purity and innocence. White can also refer to conquering, to victory. Those are two images for white in the culture at this time. This is clearly an image of military victory. I looked and there was a white horse. Its rider held a bow. He was given a crown. So the crown's not intrinsic to him. He was given to it. It was given to him rather by God. And he rode out as a conqueror bent on conquest. And that's this rider's intention, is to conquer. So this symbolizes military victory, war, basically. This is symbolizes nations going to war. The bow is a military weapon. And so, so there's that. When the Lamb opened the second seal, I heard the second living creature say, "Come." And remember, the living creatures stand for all creatures of, all the living things, like earth, basically, like the earth calling forth. I heard the second living creature say, "Come," and another horse came out. And this one was a fiery red one. And its rider was given power to take peace from the earth and to make people kill each other. And to him was given a large sword. And that actually doesn't say large sword in the Greek. I'm using the NIV, so I kept it up there. I almost changed it. But actually, literally what that word makarios means in Greek is a short sword. And you can Google this later and find this is one of the issues I have with, I won't go into that, but that's the word for short sword. In fact, sometimes it's interpreted dagger. There is actually a word for a long sword or a broad sword in Greek, and that is not it. That is the word for a short sword. Probably an editor at the end of the translation, the NIV, thought it'd be more dramatic to call it a large sword, but it actually is a short sword or a dagger. So that is significant because you would equate a bow with military conquest. A bow would be similar to, say, a missile or a tank or something at this time. And a short sword is something that people would fight with in the streets. If there was a riot or if you were being robbed by a brigand or something like this, they'd have a makarios, a short sword, right? So this second horse, this idea to make people kill each other, this is murderous behavior. We see this all the time, right? In every nation, in every people killing each other for various reasons, lawlessness, murder, this sort of thing. That's what this second rider symbolizes. So we have military conquering, people trying to conquer for their own pride or whatnot. And then we have murder. When the Lamb opened the third seal, I heard the third living creature say, "Come." I looked, and before me was a black horse. Its rider was holding a pair of scales in his hand. And I heard what sounded like a voice among the four living creatures saying, 2 pounds of wheat for a day's wages, 6 pounds of barley for a day's wages, and do not damage the oil and the wine. Now, the first time I read that, I was like, I hope someone's got an answer for me about what the heck this means. Because I don't know what that means. And there is. Actually, it's a fairly simple answer about what this means, which I was relieved to find out. So we've had war, we've had murderous behavior, say like riots in the street or murder of friends and family. What's that? Well, military victory, the first one, the white horse. Yeah. That's a good question, yes. Thanks for paying attention. So, so what this stands for is famine and economic injustice. And it doesn't jump out at you. It wouldn't jump out at us because we have to go back into that time period. So 2 pounds of wheat for a day's wages, this is basically starvation wages. This is what you'd pay in the midst of a famine. This is the lowest common denominator of what you could pay a peasant or a slave or a serf or what have you on your land that would barely keep someone alive and probably wouldn't if they had a family of any size. And you can choose between 2 pounds of wheat for a day's wages or 6 pounds of barley. Back then, wealthier people or middle-class people would tend to eat wheat, which is easier to digest, and it's more tasty and this sort of thing. It's not as coarse a grain, whereas the poor, poor peasants and slaves tended to eat barley. And so you could get paid in more barley with less nutritional value, or you could get paid in a smaller portion of wheat. And then there's this weird thing. Don't damage the oil and the wine. Well, there's lots of different interpretations of this. I'm going to give you my favorite, or at least the one that jumped out at me. Notice when it says I heard what sounded like a voice among the four living creatures. Remember the four living creatures that say come and the horses come out? This is a different thing. There's a voice that comes out among them, but doesn't come from any of them. It comes from somewhere else. What this sounds like to me, and actually it reminded me of taking annual trips to Mississippi as we do for habitat, it reminded me of sharecropping in the United States and of the abuses of the slave owners and plantation owners back then towards African Americans. This is a command. What this sounds like to me is a landowner, a person of wealth and means, saying to someone, you can have either this much wheat for a day's wage or this much barley for a day's wage, but don't you dare hurt the oil and the wine. Now, oil and wine were staples back then. It was something people had, but they weren't, you couldn't live off it, right? You can't live off oil and wine. You can live off wheat, you can live off barley, you can't live off of olive oil and wine. Those are more luxury items, right? That's what you'd buy if you had a little bit extra. And so this strikes me as an owner of land saying, you know, I'm going to pay you starvation wages, but you better not mess with the oil and wine that you're bringing to me, serving to me, that you're, you know, that you're creating, managing the vineyards, whatever. So there's a sense of injustice here. You might be starving, but don't mess with what I have. At least that's how I interpret that that line, which makes sense, because usually when there is famine in the land, when there isn't enough to go around, economic injustice is part of it. And it's not like we spread everything out equally as human beings. In fact, when we try to spread everything equally, sometimes things get worse. We don't have a cure for our sin that way. Economic injustice is just part of the deal when there's not enough to go around. When the Lamb opened the fourth seal, I heard the voice of the fourth living creature say, come. I looked, and this is the Johnny Cash line, and there before me was a pale horse. Its rider was named Death, and Hades was following close behind him. And they were given power over a fourth of the earth to kill by sword, famine, plague, and by the wild beasts of the earth. So the sword and arguably the famine could both be human events, human sin that would create death in this way. But then you have plague and wild beasts. And these, of course, are what we would call acts of God. They have nothing to do with the acts of humans. This is just punishment from God, if you will, or events caused by something that's not human. Okay, we'll keep going there. When he opened the fifth seal, I saw under the altar. So this isn't an event. This is just the fifth seal gives John a vision. Nothing happens, but he sees something. He opened the fifth seal, and I saw under the altar the souls of those who'd been slain because of the word of God and the testimony they had maintained. And they called out in a loud voice, "How long, sovereign Lord, holy and true, until you judge the inhabitants of the earth and avenge our blood?" Then each of them was given a white robe, and they were told to wait a little longer until the full number of their fellow servants, their brothers and sisters, were killed just as they had been. And I'll come back and comment on this. I'm just going to finish this up. I watched as he opened the sixth seal. There was a great earthquake. The sun turned black like sackcloth made of goat hair. The whole moon turned blood red. And the stars in the sky fell to earth as figs drop from a fig tree when shaken by a strong wind. The heavens receded like a scroll being rolled up, and every mountain and island was removed from its place. Just really incredible imagery. I love that image of the stars in the sky fell to earth as figs drop from a fig tree when shaken by a strong wind. I've never seen figs drop from a fig tree shaken by a strong wind. That's not something in my mind, but I'd love to see that just to relate it to this image and see what that looked like. For that matter, I don't know what sackcloth really looks like. These are things that we don't really use in our you can imagine, John's pulling on his culture to explain these things that he saw in his vision. Then the kings of the earth, the princes, the generals, the rich, the mighty, and everyone else, both slave and free, hid in caves and among the rocks of the mountains. They called to the mountains and the rocks, "Fall on us and hide us from the face of him who sits on the throne and from the wrath of the Lamb, for the great day of their wrath has come, and who can withstand it?" Okay. So when you read that all together, all at once, what it creates is a sense of impending doom, a sense of God's judgment. It acts as a sort of prelude to these more detailed descriptions of what's going to happen. And a sense of kind of a hopelessness, right? At least in this first initial salvo, there's not a lot of hope. God's judgment comes, people suffer. And that's, as far as these seals go, that's the message here. But there is a glimmer here, in this particular, the fifth seal. John sees under the altar the souls of those who've been slain, the martyrs. And they call out, "How long, sovereign Lord, until you judge the inhabitants and avenge our blood?" And they're given a white robe and told to wait. This brings it into our world a bit, in my view. This brings it into the life of what it means to be a Christian. What it means to be a Christian is to pursue justice and to care about justice and to be a person who is righteously angry when appropriate. Okay, to follow Jesus does not mean that's all about just forgiveness and compassion and, you did a terrible thing, but God loves you. Justice matters, and we should care about it, and we should be impassioned about it. What divides us from the rest of the world is not that. That's not what it is. In fact, Ukraine's a good example. I'll explain this in a second. I hope we all feel a similar sense of outrage about what's happening to people in Ukraine because of this unjust war by, I think, any objective measure. We should feel that, and we should be angry about it. And that's good. I mean, I think that's the Holy Spirit working within us. But I had a conversation with somebody in my extended family recently that delineated to me the difference between what it means to walk with Jesus and what it means to walk on this world. And he was saying something along the lines of, I'm just really hoping someone puts a bullet in Putin and just kills him. That's my hope. That seems like the best thing that can happen right now. It's not that as a human being, I can't relate to that. I can go full Rambo, right? I mean, let's kill them all, right? I mean, come on, that's superhero movies in essence. I mean, maybe they get beat up instead of killed, but that's what it is. It's revenge-based hope, revenge-based thinking. And I said to this individual, I can't really that can't really go down that road. I can't wish for Putin's death or that someone would assassinate him. My hope would be, and I know how crazy it sounds, but it's not totally crazy, but what a better story would it be if Putin came to his senses and started to fear God? What if Putin actually repented? What if he got terrified at the, because I think it would start with him, with fear anyway, at the notion of him being judged before the throne room of God? What if he read the book of Revelation by accident? Someone left it on his table. I mean, seriously, what if that happened? What a better story that would be. What a better tale that would be, like Nebuchadnezzar repenting, right? That someone in power who showed true viciousness or true callousness towards everybody, men, women, and children, suddenly came to his senses and repented. And indeed, maybe even tried to make his sins right with the Ukrainians or with whomever. Is that likely to happen? I wouldn't put money on it. Can it happen? Yeah, that could happen. Stranger things have happened. And when I pray, that's what I want to pray for. Now, that's for me as a Christian. And that doesn't explain how we work in the secular world. Like some of you may be judges or lawyers or police officers. You might work in the criminal world, or a soldier who fights for an army. And you have to apply differently. We do need justice in the very immediate sense in the world. We can't just say, you know, I can't go to the authorities and say so-and-so stole my car, and they can't say, well, I hope you forgive them and they repent. Like that's just not going to work. We do need to have consequences. But our prayer as Christians should always be, well, I'd like to have my car back, please, and that would be nice if you could do that. And, you know, whatever the law indicates are proper, you know, the consequences of that decision. But my prayer is that the individual who stole my car would come to know the Lord and give me back my car and then come to know the Lord and repent. Because who am I? I'm a sinner who found the Lord, right? And that's the beauty of Revelation. It is so abundantly clear that vengeance belongs to the Lord. And that's good news for me, and that's good news for you. I can't judge anybody perfectly. And we have to, if we try to judge people perfectly, then a premature bloodbath will ensue throughout the nation, throughout everything. And I do get worried sometimes about how people are getting a heightened sensitivity to sin in our culture, such that everybody is starting to get taken down, right? Because it turns out sinners are everywhere. It's getting to be a bit of a bloodbath in of itself. But we can't, we do need to pursue righteousness. We need to pursue justice. These are important things, but we cannot be the final judge. We cannot bring vengeance. That's for God to do. God alone can bring perfect vengeance. And he alone knows your heart. He alone knows the hearts of those who we look out there and we say, this person needs to die. You don't know that. We don't know. We have to make decisions in this world, but vengeance belongs to the Lord. And that's good news, because then you can let that go. You can let that go. I remember, I think I've told this story before. I think it's been a while, so I'm allowed to tell it again. There's a certain time frame. You're allowed to repeat stories after a certain number of years. But I do remember Bill Sutton, who's a U.S. history teacher, was a U.S. history teacher at Uni High, and he took students down to Clarksdale, Mississippi to do habitat work. And they interviewed, at one point, they interviewed an individual who was a sharecropper. And this individual shared about how terrible he'd been treated by the landowner. And the stories were just the worst. I mean, you can't imagine being treated that way and not wanting to kill someone who was treating you this way, right? And these Uni High students were the ones doing the interview. So these are teenage boys and girls interviewing this landowner, former sharecropper. You know, he didn't own the land. The owners owned the land, and they paid him nothing for him working the land, basically. At any rate, one of the kids asked him, because he seemed very calm and very much at peace with it. And one of the kids said, how is it that you can talk about this landowner so peaceably, so calmly, this individual who did you such wrong? Don't you want to get even? Don't you want the law to do something about this? Don't you want, you know? And the guy said, no, because he's burning in hell right now, and I'll spend eternity in heaven. And Bill Sutton, he tells the story, it's much better. We talked about how just all the students, all their jaws just all sort of dropped simultaneously. That these, for the large part, the non-believer kids tried to get that in their head, like how this individual had a certain amount of peace about this, but it was tied to this sense of vengeance that was truly like a heavy sense of vengeance, but it was God's vengeance, right? Not his. And the interesting question to ask, if I'd been there and had thought of it, to ask this individual, this would have been the interesting question. Because I understand that bringing comfort. I understand that letting God have vengeance bringing comfort and that being a peaceable thing. And I think that's great. But what if? What if that landowner was forgiven and that he'd have to meet him in heaven? Would he be okay with that? And that's a harder thing for us as Christians when someone has done us such wrong, and that person might be forgiven. Then you have to get in touch with your own sin. Because this sharecropper fellow, who I don't know, never met, was done a severe injustice. But he was a sinner too. And he sinned before God too. How? I don't know. That's between him and God. But he had to be forgiven too. And how all that all works out, I don't know, but that's in God's kingdom. And that's good news to let God have vengeance and that we don't have to carry that around on our shoulders. But it also brings comfort because all things will come before the judgment throne of God. And that is comforting. So this sixth seal, and I will explain in fullness now. Yes, I need to explain in fullness. My take on this, and to be filed under for what it's worth, and that, as I go through the book of Revelation, I will say things in this way. Some people say, well, all these things, like armies going to war, people being murderous between one another, famine, death, all these things are things that are true now, right? These are realities in the world anytime. They were realities in the world before John had his vision, right? They were realities since Adam and Eve. These are things that have happened. And so some people say, well, this is just the first four seals of just life as it has been happening as he opened the seals. I personally don't think so. And I'll tell you why in a second. I think each of these is an intensification of what's already happening. I think each of these seals as they're open are things that are already happening, getting worse. The chaos growing, the violence growing. And I think this is in keeping with the larger theme of the book of Revelation as things, that's the book of Revelation is basically a ramping up of terrible events, culminating in the victory of Christ. And that's the essence. And I think this is just the beginning salvo, as it were, of things ramping up in preparation for the second coming of Christ. And I think that's also borne out in part by this sixth seal, where there are these events, these physical events. There's a great earthquake. The sun turned black like sackcloth. What is that? Some sort of eclipse of some kind of unexpected eclipse. A blood moon. I mean, blood moons are real things, right? The moon does turn red with these astronomical events. The stars in the sky falling to earth as figs that drop from a fig tree. We've all seen that too. Well, many of us have. We've seen meteor showers, right? That would be how they would describe a meteor shower, right? An immense meteor shower. The heavens receded like a scroll being rolled up and every mountain and island removed from its place. The heavens receded like storms coming in. You've seen the heavens recede like a scroll. You've seen a heavy storm coming in. The barometric pressure drops like a stone and you see everything just roll up like a scroll and you'd be like, I better go inside. My most dramatic moments of that were at sea, because at sea you can see forever in all directions. You see a storm coming in. It is like a scroll being rolled up. Mountains and islands, you know, tsunamis, earthquakes. Things being flattened and destroyed, you know, these are things I think that are, I mean, they happen, right? Earthquakes happen, tsunamis happen, blood moons happen, they all happen. But to me, this indicates a confluence of physical events on the earth that are undeniable and terrifying. And the kings of the earth, the rich, the mighty, slave and free, all, and by the way, at this point, there's no delineation between the followers of Christ or those who don't follow Christ. It's all the same. We're all one people here so far. Everybody suffers. Everybody suffers. Fall on us and hide us from the face of him who sits on the throne and from the wrath of the Lamb. The great day of wrath has come. And then the great question that the book of Revelation answers, who can withstand it? Who can withstand the wrath of God? Who can withstand the wrath of God? Nobody. Nobody can withstand the wrath of God. You can't, except God himself. And that is why we gather at the foot of the cross and say, save us, O Lord. Save us. Before your wrath, I'm hopeless. Before your cross, I'm hopeful. No one can stand before the wrath of the Lord. So this is, yes. Did I? Before the cross, I'm hopeful. Yeah. Before your wrath, I'm hopeless. Is that, I hope that's what I said. Actually, I don't remember what I said. It's on recording. Yeah. But yeah. Thank you, John Renee. The seventh seal is open and there's silence for half an hour, but I'm going to save that for next week. And that brings in another series of events. But that's, I think that is the most intuitive way, at least the way that I interpret those first seals of the beginning of the end, as it were, of history as we know it, of human sinful history, as these seals are opened. We're going to go to communion now. Let's pray together first. Would you pray with me? Come, Holy Spirit. Come and inhabit this space right now. And I pray, Lord, that you would impress upon our hearts the deeper truths of these images, these fantastic images that John saw, that he recorded for us. Lord, I pray that we would carry these things around with us in our heart, in our mind, that we would contemplate these images, that they would challenge us, that they would draw us closer to you, and that they would put us in your throne room for worship. Now, Lord, I pray that we would be counted among those who stand in the throne room of God, who cast their crowns before you, Lord. And we take no glory for ourselves. We take no pride in ourselves. But we give you thanks, Lord, for the gift of our salvation, for the cost that you paid. Lord, teach us wisdom through these images and through these texts. May we walk closer to you because of them. I pray this in your holy name, Jesus. Amen. Now's our time of communion. And if you're in a relationship with the Lord, we invite you to the table and back.